Good morning. Please sit down. It is lovely to be here with you this morning. Welcome in the name of Christ. God's grace, mercy, and peace be with you. And our first hymn. Hymn number 431, Lord enthroned in heavenly splendor. 431.
Give us the joy of his kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. And today's collect. Almighty God, whose Son Jesus Christ fasted for 40 days in the wilderness and was tempted as we are, yet without sin, give us grace to discipline ourselves in obedience to your Spirit. And as you know our weakness, so may we know your power to save. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Gospel reading is taken from Matthew chapter 17, beginning at verse 1.
Glory to you, Lord.
After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. Just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah, talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, a bright cloud covered them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. But Jesus came and touched them. "Get up," he said, "don't be afraid." When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus instructed them, "Don't tell anyone what you have seen until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The disciples asked him, "Why then do the teachers of the law say that Elijah must come first?" Jesus replied, "To be sure, Elijah comes and will restore all things. But I tell you, Elijah has already come, and they did not recognize him, but have done to him everything they wished. In the same way, the Son of Man is going to suffer at their hands." Then the disciples understood that he was talking to them about John the Baptist. And this is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
This mysterious occurrence must have shaken to the bone the disciples that were with Jesus, Peter, James, and John. They weren't unused to seeing unusual happenings. They had seen miracles and healing and wondrous events already with Jesus. But this takes the wonder to a new level, an out of this world level. What were they expecting when Jesus led them up the mountain? Jesus went to out of the way places and up mountains on a regular basis to pray, to be with his Heavenly Father, to find reassurance and affirmation that he was on the right track in his ministry. Maybe his disciples thought they would just be with Jesus whilst he prayed, learning how to speak to God, learning how to make his type of prayer their regular routine. When this extraordinary experience unfolded, they must have been overwhelmed, well-nigh terrified, thinking they'd gone out of their minds, looking at each other for reassurance, desperate to make sense of it all. That's probably why Peter talked about making shelters for Jesus and Moses and Elijah. He couldn't think of anything better to say and needed to be grounded in the ordinary. For Jesus, this was an opportunity to feel the reality of heaven, even while his feet were still on the earth. An opportunity to go home for a little while. Before he came to earth, Moses and Elijah would have got to know him whilst in the presence of God. So the fact that they were there on a mountain is quite reasonable. It's just solidarity with Jesus. And as the vision slowly went away and normality was resumed, Jesus helped his friends to recover. And when they opened their eyes again, what would they be thinking? Did they imagine themselves rushing down the mountain shouting the equivalent of, "You'll never believe what just happened"? Or is it much more likely that they were so overwhelmed that they were rendered mute, just like Zechariah when he was told he was to have his son John? But Jesus preempts this by telling them to keep the experience for themselves until after he has risen from the dead. I wonder if they felt relief that they could process it by themselves, not having to find a meaning to relate to the other disciples. Not having to find a meaning yet. Mountaintop experiences are not just for the few, not just for the Peter, James, and Johns of this world. They come to any who are seeking to grow closer to Jesus, who are seeking to grow more like Jesus. Way back in the distant past, Holy Trinity Parish used to go away for a weekend to ride a hall near Ambleside, for the weekend after Easter. It was a time for families to get together and have fun. On this particular weekend, there was a snowstorm. And on the Saturday morning, we awoke to find the whole world was white. Brilliant, snowy white. After lunch, we went for a walk round Rydal Water, down the back route to Grasmere. Maggie had her two-year-old baby with her, so we found ourselves lagging behind the rest of the people, and so we were on our own, just our little threesome. We came to the crest of the hill and found ourselves blown away by the scene in front of us. A radiant, dazzling, spectacular whiteout that seemed to engulf us with light way beyond the natural. I remember the reaction so clearly. It was, wow. And breathless and a sense of awe in the presence of God. A few minutes later, of course, we were drawn back to the normal by little David. And on we walked to rejoin the others. I had assumed that being touched by God in that sort of way was only going to happen once or twice, three times if you're lucky. That was your ration for your life. Don't be greedy, Sylvia. Let others have a chance. But here I was so very wrong. God doesn't go in for rationing. God doesn't hold back just because you've had your share. The generosity of Almighty God, the abundance, the exuberance, overflows and is scattered around us, and all we have to do is put out our hands to receive it. Our mountaintop experiences can happen at sea level. They can happen when we walk the dog on the beach. They can happen when gazing at the snowdrops in St. Michael's Churchyard. They can happen when we witness the miracles of life that we take so very much for granted. As a student nurse, we had to go through all sorts of different experiences, and we got scheduled in to do things. And one of them was to witness the birth of a baby. It wasn't midwifery, it was just witnessing the birth. I'd done my stint in theatre, and I was very used to blood and gore, and all this seemed like a very ordinary procedure. Things were going perfectly normally, nothing unusual. Then the baby's face appeared, and the shock of the miracle of new life being seen for the first time absolutely floored me. And the other students with me. We all gasped in astonishment and then burst out crying. I have no idea what the mother thought of all this. But God had taken us up the mountain again. Eventually, Peter did talk about his experience in his letter and in person. He used it as proof that Jesus had already been glorified even before his crucifixion and resurrection. He knew it was true because he'd been there, an eyewitness. Not just as a distant spectator, but right in the middle. And it sustained Peter with all his other encounters with the risen Lord. So his ministry and mission had authenticness and authority. People sometimes say that mountaintop experiences are all very well, but you have to come down to reality. But maybe, just maybe, we can take that divine spark into our everyday life. Our enthusiasm for Jesus into our work, our hobbies, and of course our worship here in church. So my challenge for this week, and I'm sorry, I do give out challenges rather often. My challenge for this week is when we sing our next hymn, which I very much hope is what I might have said, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder. When we get to the chorus, then sings my soul, my Saviour God to thee. I would like you to close your eyes and allow yourself to be taken up that mountain to worship, so that you may fall down in awe and in wonder and in submission to the King of Kings.
Turn the cusp of Lent. We pray to the Lord for courage to give up other things, to give ourselves to Him during these 40 days. So we pray that you would give to your church the courage to give up her preoccupation with herself. More time to follow you. We pray especially for Bishop John as he prepares to come and serve us here in the Diocese of Liverpool. And for Bishop Beverly as she comes to the end of the time of leading us through interregnum. Flowing from the side of Jesus, bring forgiveness to your people and help us to face the cost of proclaiming salvation. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear our prayer. Give your world the courage to give up war, bitterness, and hatred, and to seek peace. So we pray for the Ukraine. May the shoulders of the risen Jesus, once scourged by soldiers, bear the burden of political and military conflict in our world. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear. Give us courage to give up quarrels, strife and jealousy in our families, neighbourhoods and communities. As we pray for the seemingly intractable challenges of finding a way forward for Northern Ireland. May the presence of the risen Jesus, his body once broken and now made whole, bring peace and direction as we live with one another. Let us pray to the Lord. Give us the courage to give up selfishness as we live for others and give time, care and comfort to the sick. May the wounded hands of Jesus bring his healing touch and the light of his presence fill their rooms. Let us pray to the Lord. We pray for those who are dying. Give us the courage to give up our fear of death and to rejoice with those who've died in the faith. The feet of the risen Lord Jesus, once nailed to the cross, walk alongside the dying and bereaved in their agony, and walk with us and all your church through death to the gate of glory. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear our prayer. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy.
Thank you.
our lives to be used in your service, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord is here. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and good to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, your Son. For in these 40 days you lead us into the desert of repentance, that through a pilgrimage of prayer and discipline we may grow in grace and learn to be your people once again. Through fasting, prayer, and acts of service, you bring us back to your generous heart. Through study of your holy word, you open our eyes to your presence in the world and free our hands to welcome others into the radiant splendour of your love. As we prepare to celebrate the Easter feast with joyful hearts and minds, we bless you for your mercy and join with saints and angels forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit the broken bread and wine outpoured. May it be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine again, he praised you, gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you, this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence, his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory O Lord, so loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. So we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to deceive you, but only say the word. as we walk with you on your path of obedience. Sustain us on our way and lead us to your glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and King and Savior, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you all and remain with you, now and forevermore.